Ben, thanks for being here today. I wanted to begin with a question that's very broad and then from there kind of get more specific. We hear almost constantly that architecture, design, the creative industries can contribute to a better world. How does architecture lead to a better world?
Technology gives us now much better insights in how clean indoor environments and outdoor environments are. As you know, I have this interest in, of course, the outdoor environment, but I'm also interested in the way how you can use data measuring, etc., the way how you can improve the environment alone for the outdoors, but also for the indoors. And now I can come up with data and say, yeah, listen, with this better air system or acoustic series of materials or non-toxic materials, we have proven that we could reduce down sick leave. And this is where it counts, that something works to make this world better. I lately hear also that clients and the investors I work with together, they are fascinated in this idea of post-occupancy research, because they want to know that after 2 or 3 years, that this building is still as sustainable and as healthy as we promised them. And this is what I really like, because this gives the opportunity to say, listen, you know, we can't greenwash anymore, because that's what happened maybe the last 40, 50 years a lot, that we promised a lot of a green building or a better environment, etc. But then over the years, then, you know, the filters were not cleaned in the air system or the whole maintenance. Then after 5 years, the building is not anymore as healthy as you thought. So technology can help us a lot to direct and combine the different parameters of how to make a world better.
And that's interesting, because what you're suggesting is the building kind of is constantly collecting data and that there's an evaluation phase later. Does this mean perhaps that the role of the architect in this case, or the designer generally, is not only up front? The architect prepares a project, the project is executed, and generally that's the end of our relationship. But when you talk about this kind of ongoing process of evaluation, adaptation, do you think that it may lead to a kind of questioning of where the ending point is of that relationship between the designer and the client?
Before it was so that the client would say, yeah, this is my brief, and I could say, well, you know, this is my design, and if you don't like it, then I'm out. You know, so, you know, there was a kind of a little bit of polarization happening between the client and the architect. That polarization is changing in one way or the other in a more positive direction, because clients at the moment don't know how to make the most optimum, sustainable, healthier and more circular buildings. They know they have to follow the ESG rules. They know that they have to implement that in their own company. But what is now interesting is that and the clients are coming with their specialist to the table, sustainable specialist, economical specialist. I have my own specialist, and more as a team, you have to collaborate together on this most ideal, more sustainable, but also, of course, within the budget, organized project. And that makes it, in one way or the other, fascinating to talk about technology adaptation and how over time a building hopefully can then stay sustainable. And don't forget, that is changing, because some of the investors, they have only an interest in a 5-year lifespan, because they sell the building then again to another company or another investor. But the ones who are actually at the moment very serious about the topic is the long-time investors in the real estate world, because they think, oh, sustainability is going to be not only important for the next 3 years, but over the next 5 to 10, 20 years.
So you've talked about, let's say, indoor air quality or things that are measurable at the level of the building, but you also talk about circularity, and this is a big topic for you. When we talk about circularity, of course, there's the individual object, which is important, but then there's a system, right, that goes beyond. What is the role of the individual designer in this system of circularity?
The designer can make the most sustainable and in the same time circular building, but then you have to explain it. What can you do with the materials after 10 years when maybe you really like to adapt the building, for instance, and change some of the elements in the building? So some of the steel work can maybe taken out and maybe be sold in the material passport you can generate for this project. try there where it's possible to bring in a material passport so that all the materials are collected in this passport, and that over time these materials get their own particular value as well, so that they can be exchangeable and hopefully be sold again on the market. Yeah, we thought that material passports were interesting, but slowly on, we do get also resource passports, where and how we can find the resources of used material to be implemented in buildings. And that is for us new. That is only something coming up over the last 5 to 6 years, that you can find materials who have been used and can be reused.
I think we can say today, for a building to perform properly, it has to be, let's say, environmentally responsible, right? This is on the one hand.
Yeah.
What does it do? And the other is something harder to categorize, but it's more spiritual, more something that creates a sensation or somehow resonates with something deep within us. I think within the modern movement, early in the modern movement, we had this moment where, let's say, a machine aesthetic was somehow meant to resonate with people, right? It seems to me we haven't yet reached a moment where there is necessarily kind of an expressive architecture of circularity or architecture of sustainability, right? That would somehow capture that other part. Where do you think that kind of architecture might emerge? Slightly more, I don't know, emotionally grounded spiritual architecture of sustainability. Is this possible?
In the future of architecture, sustainability, circularity, and health, they should be the new motor for the way how we can make environments for people and the planet hopefully better. So a more human-centric or more deeper human-centric approach for that reason is incredibly important in architecture. In our work, and in my teaching also, I stimulate always the idea of what can we do in order to change the typology of work or office buildings. So after the call it the software, the motivation and the performance of architecture, you need to bring it towards an organization. And the third layer for me is the aesthetic, what you call also the spiritual or the call it the cultural edge of architecture. But it is to be found in a new type of overall experience whereby you feel also happy about that you live in a better world or in a better environment or in a healthier environment. It's like eating good food, for instance, or healthier food, that it uplifts you a little bit. And this kind of new aesthetical experience is going to be definitely something new to work on. But that brings me maybe to the most important change in design is this aspect of experiential design as well. We all know what architecture should give, but the experience of architecture gives a new type of layer whereby you have to think about how people move through the building and what do they express themselves in this environment and what does the building really express in this environment.
I wanted to wrap up by talking about AI. I know at UNStudio you guys are already working quite intensively with artificial intelligence and architecture, and depending on what you read, it's either the end of architecture or the beginning of some promising new utopic phase. Probably, as is mostly the case, it lies somewhere in between those poles. How are you using it, and where do you see it taking design, broadly speaking?
I use it quite a lot. I have a team of AI specialists who are fascinated simply because they are of the generation of AI. And the way how we use it is to test through AI if our carbon footprint is good enough with 6 variants of designs we come up with. And yeah, it's related to the way how the operation of the building or the performance of the building is already giving you numbers. Very quick numbers, you know, the engineers could not do it 10 years ago. Now as an architect, I can do it within an hour. What kind of carbon footprint these different variants give to me, or the performance of the carbon footprint. I use it in many ways. I use it myself. Sometimes if I am preparing my talk for the way how we have come up with a design, have a good storytelling, an argument around the project, and I think, it's not sharp enough. Can I give it another structure? I put I pull my whole text into the computer and it gives me, AI gives me a better structured argument. Don't get me wrong, I don't believe AI can actually take away the designer, because AI will never generate open top-notch originality. All the parameters are so complex, and that's good, because I think it can help you with production. When we were still drawing with hand, what I did, I was still having my classical way of making my drawings. And then CAD came in, and then BIM came in, and then, you know, technology will always help us in one way or the other. So I'm not so scared of AI. But you need to know how to use it. I think that's the key.
Thanks very much, Ben. It was a pleasure to speak with you today.
Thank you.